Hi, I'm Graham Steele, Head of Product for Cyber here at SandboxAQ, and today I am joined by Deirdre Connolly.
Hi.
Worked in cryptography for a number of years. Is it fair to say you're an influencer in cryptography?
One could use that term.
We may say that. Okay, awesome, fantastic. Well, thanks so much for joining me here today. So we've been talking about a lot of topics in cryptography that are hot at the moment. One of those is post-quantum cryptography.
Yep.
And you do a lot of work in standards, right? Mm-hmm. This is one of your things. So can you help us to understand where are we right now in the process of post-quantum cryptography, PQC standardization, in particular by the NIST organization?
Yes, US-based National Institutes of Standard and Technology are leading the way globally in trying to set up formal standards for new post-quantum algorithms for key establishment, mm-hmm. which I'll be throwing around a term called a chem, and also post-quantum signatures, which are very, very similar to the signatures we've been using in cryptography for a long time. They have put out kind of first and last drafts of the standards that they're looking to finalize by the end of this summer, but it's probably going to be more like September, mm-hmm. For one key establishment mechanism called ML-CHEM, formerly known as Kyber, and three digital signature algorithms, MLDSA, formerly known as Dilithium, Falcon, and I think the other one is stateless hash-based signatures. The first two things I mentioned are based on structured lattices. Third one I mentioned is also based on lattices, but of a slightly different character, and the third one is based on hashes, mm-hmm. Hashes all the way down.
Right.
So when these standards are finalized, I think three of those four are scheduled to be finalized September-ish, we will have brand new standards that the U.S. government allows for its systems and any contractor systems that needs to integrate with it, or any application that needs to be FIP certified, to do key establishment and new digital signatures. And there's a reason there's three digital signatures, because one, these are new cryptographic problems, new mathematical problems that we're basing cryptography on, and they wanted to have a bit of a diversity of what use cases you can have to base them on different problems. So not all your eggs are in one basket, but also they have different structural characteristics when they're in use. So they have different sizes of public keys and signatures, they have different performance qualities, and they have different security properties in use depending on where you use them. We only have the one CHEM that's currently scheduled to be finalized this year. There are still some other CHEMs that are being discussed, but that's going to take a little bit longer. So we'll have ML-CHEM ready to go this year so that you can start swapping out your things that might have used things like elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman, mm-hmm. For something that might use this CHEM based on lattices or some sort of hybrid.
Right. So that term CHEM, just get that like totally down.
Yeah.
So it's KEM, Key
Correct.
Encapsulation Mechanism.
Yes.
So this is a way that I send around a if I'm getting this right, a symmetric key, right? I encapsulate it in a way that it's going to be used somewhere else. Is that fair?
Not almost.
Really. Almost.
You're using public key encryption, which is based on these new lattice problems or other post-quantum problems, to encrypt something that instead of like your message that you encrypt and decrypt with public key encryption, it's almost like a randomness seed.
Okay.
And then using that seed material, your ciphertext that you're actually sending around, and your public key and secret key material, all together will spit out something that's called the share secret. Mm-hmm. It's not the same value as that like seed randomness that you're encrypting and decrypting under the hood. And it's, to get nerdy about it, it's very interesting how there's different ways to construct CHEMs that result in different, slightly different properties in the way you can compute that final shared secret. Because some of them do that kind of thing you originally said, which is the secret that I'm, or the seed randomness that I'm encrypting and decrypting is the shared secret. But a lot of them, and including ML-CHEM that's being standardized, do not do it exactly like that, because it gives you more robustness in the security of the scheme if you don't do that.
All right. Wow. Okay. Interesting. That's great. So then, and then you mentioned this thing about we're using these different mathematical kind of notions to construct these different candidates. So that's because we don't want to put our eggs in one basket. So I've heard recently about, you know, there's been these kind of new results floating around lattice cryptography, which is like one, you're saying that's like the one of the bases for these things.
Yes.
Should I I be worried about that?
We were worried for a few days, and then there were significant bugs found in these new result papers. They were theoretically going to make a lot of, but not all of, lattice cryptography fundamentally vulnerable.
Right.
We are not worried anymore about those specific results. But we're still trying to figure out if they have any implications for improving some of the baseline attacks against lattice cryptography in general, in very specific applications, or any thereof. We currently are fine and still moving forward with basically all the lattice-based schemes and constructions that are either being standardized or very advanced and not nowhere close to being standardized. But we're sort of keeping an eye out to see if any of these new results have any fallout in the coming months or years about, like, that approach didn't work, but maybe that gives somebody else an idea to be like, ah, well, this solves a gap in an attack I tried or an approach that didn't quite work.
Right.
We don't know if there will be fallout. We currently, we breathed a sigh of relief a couple of weeks ago. Those papers were put out. And then they were like, nope, there's a fundamental bug. This doesn't work anymore.
All right, all right. Well, I'm glad you're not worried, because you've made, I'm a little worried now. No, but anyway, if you're not worried, then I'm not worried. So I think we're good.
Yeah, not worried anymore.
All right, so then what I've heard from some of the people I've been speaking to recently about their program for adopting this PQC once these standards come out, and they're going to be FIP standards, right?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. So they're going to be FIP standards. So if I'm a FIPS regulated organization, or it's applied to the government, then, you know, this is something I can use.
Yeah.
Is that, well, okay, so we've got these little worries about the security of these new things. Maybe what I should be looking to do is set up what we call a hybrid scheme, right? Where we use, like, both our old cryptography and this new PQC thing. Is that what I should be doing? Is that the best way to go forward?
Maybe. It depends. For things that are doing key establishment, so using a chem probably if you're trying to move into a quantum resilient posture, probably you may want to try a hybrid, especially if your organization or your technology is able to go through more than one migration, because basically everyone in the area agrees that going to a hybrid and staying there forever is not the ideal scenario. Eventually, we would want a much simpler protocol or deployment where you don't have all these things living side by side forever.
So it's just a complexity. That's why I don't want to do it forever.
Pretty much, especially for key agreement. If you can go from classical cryptography, which is elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman, mostly maybe there's some RSA in there for your current key agreement, to a hybrid, and then eventually from the hybrid to fully post-quantum, when we're all pretty secure in ML chem or any other chem that's, you know, in wide usage. There are hybrid constructions out there, especially for hybrid key agreement, that people are pretty solid about. Hybrid signatures are kind of a different beast.
Right.
The reason that hybrid key agreement is kind of like, we have good, robust solutions for it that we feel confident recommending to people, and the threat of a future quantum computer decrypting traffic that's being encrypted and stored now, like right now, in the future, is like a current day threat. We have to worry about it today, even if the attacker exists in the future.
Right.
Versus signatures, you're verifying authentication properties. And usually that's tightly scoped, both in time and in the capability that you're trying to authenticate against, whether you're allowed to do something or something is valid. We are less worried about those attacks because they tend to be on a narrower scope, and they tend to have a slightly more advanced attacker, as opposed to a passive attacker who can slurp up all your ciphertext and just kind of wait for a day where they can pick and choose what thing to decrypt when they have their computer. When you are interfering with signatures, you're trying to interfere with something that you're checking now, and then if it does not pass, you stop doing something.
Right.
So for hybrid signatures, we have a little bit more roadmap to see if we can move directly to post-quantum signatures. Or, for example, if you have certificate chains or chains or signing chains, you may have parallel chains.
Right.
You may have a traditional elliptic curve or RSA-based signature chain, and you may have your fully post-quantum thing and just have them side by side or something like that.
So there's no to sort of mix them up, so it's a little bit simpler to kind of keep the two separate.
It may be possible to just co-sign things, and instead of them being like a true hybrid, you're just doing both, and you check whichever one is valid in your policy at the protocol level or the policy level.
Got it.
There are options for signatures that range from something like I just described, a kind of like co-signing, to all the way to a new signing algorithm that relies on both of the post-quantum hard problems and the classical hard problems. And it gets a lot of nice properties, but it requires a brand new signature to be deployed. And so if you can wait, it may be in your interest to wait before deploying hybrid signatures.
Right. So if you can wait, it's good to wait because you might get something simpler in the end, basically.
Yes. And especially for things like certificates, for the web PKI, or maybe for application signing or anything like that, if you're able to tightly scope in the like policy of the thing you're signing, how long this thing should be valid for. For example, web PKI certificates, 3 months is a norm now. Like having a certificate that only lives for a couple of weeks is very common.
Yeah.
Having an application signed bundle only being valid for, I don't know, maybe a year is common, but I think there is a big trend of automating and keeping certificate and signing lifetimes tightly scoped so you can rotate a lot. And that gives us a lot more bandwidth to go to these models that are simpler in terms of moving towards post-quantum than like deploying this hard to migrate off of hybrid construction if you don't have to. So.
Okay. Awesome. Got it. Okay. So these standards are coming, these FIP standards. They're going to give me my chem. They're going to give me some of these signatures. Mm-hmm. So does that mean once those things arrive and you're saying maybe September or, you know, it's supposed to be July or whatever, but it's probably going to be September. So when I get them, can I just go right then, or do I have to wait for these to get into like more upstream standards before I can really adopt?
So there's a lot of commonly used protocols such as TLS, SSH. You can argue whether that's a standard, and things like IPsec that are moving quite fast on the key agreement stuff.
Right.
For example, TLS 1.3 is currently supports hybrid key agreement, and as a well-supported draft. Mm-hmm. It's deployed in Chrome. It's deployed on Cloudflare. And I think Cloudflare just reported that 20% of their connections, their TLS connections, are using post-quantum hybrid key agreement now. Okay. And they only, in concert with Chrome, that only got deployed a couple of weeks ago.
Okay.
So when those FIP standards land, they're using kind of the draft right now. When this FIPs, and unfortunately, we people who have been keeping up with NIST are like, oh, are you going to have like a last draft that we can like see before like the final thing lands? They're like, no. So we implementers and protocol designers and standards people will be the final standard. Any diffs between the last document that they shared and the final standard, which they said that there will be, we'll have to update the implementation of the primitive, the chem, and then update any implementations of TLS, for example, that use that library. It's easier to update the standard to be like, oh, this is the final reference for the final standard, and tweak anything in the document that says anything that differs. And update all the links. So there will be a little bit of lag time between when a standard drops in September and when everything is fully, and this does not count for FIP certification. FIP certification is another ball of wax that takes a long time, but your software and your implementations and your standards and your protocols will be basically just shy of FIP certification a couple of months.
Right.
After these drop in September, I would guess, especially, you know, your Googles, your OpenSSLs, and other well-maintained stacks.
Right.
For other things, it might take a little bit longer, but I'm most familiar with things like TLS. They're as on the front foot and like ready as basically a well-distributed protocol can be.
All right, awesome. So if I'm running the TLS policy for my organization and serving up sensitive traffic or whatever, and I want to move to a post-quantum secure posture, so then the standards drop in September. People like you run around updating standards to make sure that the TLS 1.3 standard is got the latest changes in. Then we have to wait for that to propagate into, you mentioned Chrome, but you know, other browsers too need to adopt it so they're ready to receive my traffic. And then I'm going to update my servers with whatever libraries I use to get that going. So that's the sort of process I'm going to go through. So, but an interesting thing about that is that that requires me to use TLS 1.3, right?
Correct.
So I need to, I mean, a lot of organizations would love to be there, but haven't moved to TLS 1.3. And in some places we've heard in the government sector, they actually like are not too excited about adopting TLS 1.3 for reasons that we can go into about, you know, wanting to put boxes in the middle of certain traffic. What about if I'm stuck on TLS 1.2? Do I ever get post-quantum cryptography? Or how's that going to shake out?
Probably not, because the TLS working group has passed documents that said no more updates to TLS 1.2. Like, it's basically in like deprecation, like we're just keeping it alive mode. There are no signals and active anti-signals for any post-quantum support in TLS 1.2 or any version below TLS 1.3.
Wow. Okay. This is going to be really interesting to see how that all shakes out. All right. Awesome. So don't forget to subscribe to the SandboxAQ channel and make sure you don't miss a video. We're going to have some links under the video to some more of this information so you can track how the standards are evolving. I'm just going to say thank you, Deirdre, so much.
Thank you, Graham.